Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, "Woman, behold your son."
Yeah.
Then he said to the disciple, "Behold your mother."
Yes.
And from that hour, the disciple took her to his own home. Mm-hmm. For a very brief time, we will not be able to look into all of that goes on here, but for a very brief time, we want to talk to you about the healing look of love. The healing look of love.
Yes.
The impact of this event. We are here celebrating an event that has changed the history of the world.
Oh, yes.
The crucifixion. I'm mighty afraid that sometimes in our celebration of this event, we don't feel the emotions and the pain and the horror and the weight of what was going on there. We have now sanitized it where it's just a cute story. Mm-hmm. Peter Rabbit is hopping down the bunny trail and all kinds of things. You're going to hide some Easter eggs and you're going to do some things. And all in the name of celebrating what happened on this day and throughout Sunday. Mm-hmm. It's very troubling to me that even in these kinds of events, we sometimes lose our focus on what is actually going on. I'm here to just try to, for a brief moment, bring you to that point in time so you can feel what was happening at that moment and the weight of it, so that your salvation now has more value, that you're not just going through motions. The impact of this event on the witnesses stood out in their lives at that moment. The effect of this momentous event going forward is felt in their lives and in the lives of those who hear the story from them. This particular crucifixion, this is not the first crucifixion. The Romans had used this form of capital punishment.
Yes.
But this particular crucifixion, this one that happens that we celebrate today, stands at the juncture of history that connects and changes history in the way that has never happened before or since. No event has ever caused the world to be so profoundly affected as this crucifixion. But imagine, if you will, what is going on in the minds of those who are at the cross witnessing what is going on. We have three central characters. We have Jesus, who's on the cross. We have his mother, Mary.
Yes.
And we have the beloved disciple, John. These three figures are the focus of this scripture, because there's something that is going to happen that is miraculous even while Jesus is hanging on the cross. Have you ever wondered, what was Mary thinking about watching this event? Some of you as mothers have lost children. I'm imagining how that mother felt about the young man in Sacramento that lost his life. Here's Mary, who has birthed Jesus. The angel came to her and said, "You're highly favored." I'm not sure she's feeling very favored right now. She came to him and said, "You're going to bear a son, and he's going to be the savior of the world." The shepherds come to the birth of him and say, "Hey, this is the one."
Yes.
Wise men travel from the east and bring him gifts. Yes. Her mind is reflecting on all the things that has happened up to this point.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
She remembers his very first miracle in Cana of Galilee.
My Lord.
She's watched him for his adult life. At one point when he was 12 years old, she watched him in the temple.
All right, now.
She's remembering that she had to leave her home country to go to Egypt for a number of years because they were trying to kill him. All this is going on in Mary's mind as she remembers with pride how he walks and how he's conducting himself. No doubt she was sometimes concerned about him on his itinerant mission journey, on his ministry in this world. But she sees with pride what he was doing. She sees him healing the sick and raising the dead. She sees all the miracles.
Oh, yes.
But now she's here at this moment. Mm-hmm. At this time.
Yeah.
And here he is hanging on the cross. Mm-hmm. No doubt she watched him go from judgment hall to judgment hall. No doubt she watched him being dehumanized. No doubt she watched people disparaging him. She hears everything that's going on regarding her son.
Yeah.
You need to feel the weight of what's going on with this woman.
My Lord.
And now he's hanging on the cross and she's standing nearby. She can't reach out and touch him. She can't do anything. She's feeling hopeless and she's feeling helpless because her son, who was called to be the Savior of the world, is hanging on a cross. She's feeling it. Are you feeling it this morning, this afternoon? Are you feeling that? Or is this just a cute story for you? Then there's John. John was the one that he called, and John laid on his breast, and John was called from the ship. He left his mother and father and the family business, and he pins his hopes on this Jesus. His hopes and his dreams, and he even his mama went to him and said, "Yeah, I know you didn't want. Can you do something special for my children?"
All right.
John loved him.
Yes.
John followed him. John witnessed things. John knew he was the Christ. He knew he was special because he was there at the Mount of Transfiguration.
All right.
He was there when God spoke from heaven saying, "This is my son."
Yes, yes.
You may know Moses and you may know Elijah, but this is my son.
Come on, Reverend.
He was there at the baptism when God spoke from heaven and says, "This is my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased." But John now was feeling the weight that his hopes and his dreams and his aspirations that is attached to this man is dying with Jesus on the cross. He feels the weight because he was his best friend. I know when I've gone to services and my best friend is there, I feel the weight, I feel the pain. But in this instance, he feels even more because his life was attached. His hope was attached. His dream was attached. He had proclaimed, he had went out preaching when Jesus commissioned him. So here he is. But at this juncture of time, at this moment in time, Jesus is suffering all the pains of crucifixion. Nails in his hands and in his feet. He's suffering pain, but in the midst of his pain, he looks and he sees. He looks and he sees. While he's suffering for the sins of the world, he sees his suffering mother. And he sees his suffering friend. Not only does he look, but he sees. And from his vantage point on the cross, he sees, in spite of his own pain, his own agony, he sees his mother. He feels her pain. He sees the side of her. He sees that one. Have you noticed that Jesus is an individual God? That he meets you?
Yes,
no matter where the crowds are, crowds are all around him, but he stops with directly to you in this instance. He sees, no matter all the thousands of people that are witnessing, he focuses on his mother. And he focuses on his friend. And then he acts. He looks. He's healing right now. The healing look of love bridges the gap between her pain and John's pain, and he heals them at that instance, and John takes her home with him. He looked, he bridged, and he healed. But let me tell you, brothers and sisters, as I go to a close, he didn't stop there. He continued to bridge the gap between us and God. His whole purpose of being on that cross was to bridge the gap between man and God. Let me tell you something, he's not on the cross anymore. But he is looking from a heavenly vantage point. He says, "Father, behold your children. Children, behold your father." He's still looking with the healing look of love. He's still healing with the look of love. He's still recovering with the healing look of love. He's still reconciling with the healing look of love. He's still comforting with the healing look of love. He is still redeeming with the healing